Amen. His word is settled in heaven. When he said it is settled, it is settled. No negotiation. Nothing can contend against it. Nothing can work against it because the word is settled. Because he himself doesn't change. Because he's not man. The word is settled. So if you are here this morning, I don't know what is going on in your closet. I don't know what is going on in your house. I don't know what is going on in your pocket. I don't know what is going on in your family. I don't know what is going on within you yourself. He says he has settled it. He has what? Settled it. So there could be anxiety in us. We could have fear in us because we can't even see the future clear for ourselves. But he says it is settled. That is his word. It comes with authority. Sometimes even the American dream, though you are here, but it is so far away from you. You are living in it, but you are not experiencing it. He said his word is settled. It is settled. People are developing, but you are disintegrating. People are getting married, but you are losing your marriage. You are losing your family. People are having testimonies, but you are having afflictions. In fact, it looks like you are holding on precariously onto life just to survive. He says his word is settled. And if you belong to any of the groups I have already enumerated, I have good news for you this morning. Amen. I have good news for you this morning. Amen. I have good news for you this morning. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Exodus, chapter number 2. We are going to read from verse 23 to 25. Exodus 2. 23 to 25. And I read. During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out. And their cry for help, because of their slavery, went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered them, his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. Amen. Amen. Some other version said, he remembered them.
That's right.
And I hope today God remember you. He will remember you because he doesn't forget his children, because he had a covenant with our father Abraham, and that covenant is still working. Amen.
Amen.
Let's bow down our heads and pray. Father Almighty, we thank you this morning for the service. We thank you for the praise and worship. We thank you for our presence. We call on you this morning to descend into our midst. Come down into our midst. Come and teach us. Come and train us and transform us if you want to good works. That you raise up your standard against anything that you want to steal away from your way this morning. We continue to pray unto you to ask that you speak. Let the Holy Spirit speak through man. So that at the end of the day, your children, your sins will be exalted. And they will be sharp even in the kingdom. So at the end of the day, Lord, Your kingdom will be the one that will benefit. This I pray at you through your son Jesus Christ. And all the saints shall say, Amen. Amen. I would like to tell us a very short story. I'm a storyteller. And I don't do anything without telling stories. I am a teacher by gift. So I tell stories. So forgive me those who may not be that conversant with the story. But I think you pick one or two away from it. Amen. I come from Ghana. And I lived my life, the better part of my life, at a place called Medina. Though I moved later to a place called North Legon, but I've been in Medina for a very long time. And that is where my story is coming from. We had a neighbor called Mr. Tete. This Mr. Tete was just an ordinary man who was working at US of Ghana, Legon, as a laborer. So he didn't have much money, but he tried so hard. So before he went on pension, he bought a piece of land and built a what you call chamber and a hall. Two chamber and a hall, speaking four rooms. And he and his wife and children were living comfortably. And you know that back home in Ghana, somebody building a chamber and a hall will not even be able to afford pipe-borne water in his house. So you have to go to the neighbor to fetch water and pay. Or you pay monthly. So this is what he was doing. But before he came and lived on the land, he grew some trees. And this man is not the modern person who will have flowers. He will plant trees that will give him fruits. So he planted fruits. He planted this fruit-bearing trees on the compound. And there was one particular tree, an orange tree, that wasn't growing. It was stunted. And it came to a time where he thought of cutting it. I said, all right, let me leave it and see. So everybody forgot about this tree. Everybody forgot about this tree. But one day, some way, somehow, he got some money. He said, look, let me do my wife's show. Let me do my children's show so that they stop carrying buckets on their head, fetching water from outside. So he drew water into the house. And even where to locate the standing pipe was a problem. Because you have to locate it in such a way that when one of your children gets money and wants to do an extension, you know what I mean? They will not have to be relocating the pipe. So just locating a pipe was like a nightmare. He thought about it for a long time. And eventually, he located it somewhere. And life went on. But one day, he woke up in the morning. Then he realized that this tree that I have forgotten is now bearing fruits. The tree is now growing big. I cannot sit under it. And within a year, it has grown bigger than all the other trees on the compound. So he started thinking, for all these years, what went on? Why now? Why today? He started thinking. Then it clicked him that it is because of the pipe born water that he drew into the house. Because when they fetch water, you know, some overflow. So it flows down to this tree. So the problem for this tree was that it wasn't getting water. The problem was that it wasn't getting water. And now that started getting water, it has been restored to where it's supposed to be. Grown big, now bearing fruit, and they can sit under. And all the community of trees in the house were no longer laughing at it. Today, if you are here and you are a laughing stock, today, if you are in this house and things didn't go on well for you, if you are in this house and people are just laughing at you, if you are in this house
And people are just walking at you. Because I'm so sure that tree was being mocked by the others. Because it wasn't bearing fruits. They couldn't even sit under it. Your pipe, your water, your source of water is coming. Your source of water is coming. Nobody ever thought that this tree will also be able to bear fruits. So despite your pain, because the tree was in pain, because it was nearly cut down, it was nearly healed. Because Jesus said, if you are not bearing fruits, I will cut you down, I will heal you. So it was at the verge of being cut down. So maybe you are at the verge of being cut down. In whatever life status you find yourself in, I tell you, your source of water is coming. If you are in any kind of disappointment, you are beautiful, you are handsome, but I mean, some way, somehow, you cannot land yourself on a good partner. You cannot land, you are educated, you have profession, but you cannot land a good job. Your source of water is coming. You are struggling in life. You started long ago. I mean, we say back up We started long ago, but we still not gotten there. Your source of water is coming. With all your inadequacies, sometimes maybe you are inadequate. We cannot fit within society. I mean, if you look at yourself, I mean, comparing yourself with other people, you are inadequate. It looks like you don't fit in. Your source of water is coming. You see, you are going to be restored. God is going to kickstart you again. Your living water is coming. You see, this tree, that was a laughing stock in that house, if it were a human being. I mean, where will it get water from? Because for so many years, it was stunted, no source of water. It may have all the manure in the house, because all the other trees were growing fine. But look, if those who know Medina very well, where I lived, our source of water is from home, hundreds of miles away. The tree wasn't uprooted and planted over there. But some way, somehow, pipe came from home through Afiena, through Tema, then came to store at a place called Okonglo, where the distribution point is. Then it was distributed, they went to Legon, then went to Medina, took some time, then went to Mr. Tete's house. And Mr. Tete was, and in some ways, God manipulated his mind, and then he went to locate that pipe close to that tree that didn't have life. I don't care where you find yourself today. I don't care. I really do not care. Maybe you are not even at a good place. Maybe you are not even at the job that you are supposed to be. I don't really care. But God will, some way, somehow, God will bring the living water to you. I don't care. I don't care. You see, sometimes you may be thinking, how will I get the living water? Or where is the promise of God? Because God has not spoken to me yet. I've not heard the voice of God yet. At least Bishop, who is a prophet, has not prophesied to me as yet. He has not told me anything that God has told him to tell me. God has spoken a lot. Because if you go to the book of Genesis, God made a covenant with Abraham that you are going to be the father of many nations. And you see that land. Look at it, where your eye gets to, that is where I will give the land to you up to that very point. But then he didn't have a son. He said, I will give you a son. The wife was barren, he himself couldn't make babies, and he was an old man. But God didn't care. God did not care. And then this same covenant also extended to his son Isaac. The same in Genesis. Those who want to write, the first one is Genesis chapter 15, verses 18 to 21. That's the very first covenant. And then the covenant also extended to the son Isaac in Genesis 16, verse 3 to 5. That because your father obeyed, because he obeyed, the covenant is still standing. Then it also extended to his grandson or his son, Jacob, that the whole world is going to be blessed through you. So are you not blessed? The whole world is going to be blessed through Abraham, who is our father. But at least anytime we pray, we say, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, and God of Jacob. We are the grandchildren of these patriots. And so the covenant that made Abraham had a baby when he was 100 years, that same covenant that caused Isaac, that same covenant that came to Jacob, is still applicable to you and I. So if we have not seen anything at all, if Bishop has not told us anything at all, at least we know that we are going to be blessed through them. So it doesn't matter where we find ourselves, God is going to bring the living water to us. God is working behind the scenes. Sometimes we say, maybe I am suffering, things are not working for me. But he said in Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 3, that write my words, write them, so I could be, when you are running, you can reach them. At the appointed time, he will do his job. So maybe what you are going through right now, maybe just a matter, you are being trained. Because let me tell you something, there are some of us in this house, when we are being given $1 million today, we will not know how to use it. It will get finished very soon. So many people have won a lot of lotteries. The last time somebody won over 700 million. And people of that sort have been winning lotteries since I was born. How many of them have joined the club of billionaires in this country? Because there is difference between riches and wealth. Man can give you riches, but God gives you wealth. God gives you wealth when he directs his source to you. But man can give you riches and it will get finished tomorrow. So you are not worthy today, because God is preparing you. So it doesn't matter what you are going through today. So for me, when I'm going through problems, it is painful though, but at all times it is at the back of my mind, because I know that I will fall upon this tomorrow, and that's what's going to put me to wherever God wants to take me to. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Psalms. We are going to read from verse 1 to 3. As we are in the home stretch. We are getting to the end. And there is something God is saying over here. I don't know why the psalmist put this in chapter 1. I don't know why. And not in the middle of chapter 1, but the beginning of chapter 1. Meaning it is very important for you and I. It is very, very significant. Because where you put things are important, depending upon the situation you find yourself. I am a number person, so I understand numbers, I understand positions. So for this being the very first book of Psalm chapter 1, and then we have verse 1 to 3, it is very important. Amen. If you are there, let me read. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of scornful mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. He meditates on it day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water, that brings forth its fruits in season.
His leaf shall never wither, and whatever he does prospers. Amen. God has given a caveat. You and I, you know the blessing, the Abrahamic blessing is there for us. So it doesn't really matter if we are going to touch it or it's going to catch up with us. That blessing is already there for us. But he has brought up a caveat. He has brought up a caveat. So that as you move, as you live, as you talk, as you go to church, whatever you do, you look at that caveat. But am I walking in the counsel of the ungodly? Am I standing in the way of sinners? Am I rubbing shoulders with sinners? Those who are sinners, though I'm coming to church, am I part of them? Do I scheme with them? Do I do things with them? That's what God is saying. Am I standing? Am I sitting with mockers? I don't know the United States in this room, but sometimes it is also good to go local. You sit with people and things you say are not edifying. You know that the things that come out of my mouth become sound and they affect us. So if you sit with mockers and you say things that are not edifying, you are charting the course of your own future. So God is saying that you are not going to be blessed if you are such a person. But if you delight in the things of the Lord and you meditate upon it morning, afternoon, evening, and in the night, you will be like something. Meditate upon it. Because when you meditate upon something, it becomes part of you. It becomes part of you. Sometimes you say it involuntarily. Because there are things we say that we don't think of. And if you live among people who use flowers, you end up using the same flowers. Maybe you have lived among these people and they use flowers anyhow, but maybe today I have found myself in the group of the bishops. Then a similar thing happens, then that word comes out. First impression. So words are important, the things you put in you, because you are what you put in you. You are what you put in you. He said, if you don't do those things, you will be like a tree that is planted by rivers of water. Amen. God is not going to uproot you and go and plant you where a river is. When they say rivers of water, you know, when you have a big field planted with crops, the crops must be watered. So you channel a water source through them that will water the field. So God is not uprooting you and planting you by any other source. But where you find yourself today, where you are, God is going to channel his source of water to you. Because he did it to that tree in Mr. Mensah's house back in Medina. He channeled the water from home all the way to his house. So I don't care wherever you find yourself today. God is going to channel the source of water to wherever you are. And he says, it bringeth forth its fruit in season. In season. We are here this morning. We are worshiping God. We are praising God. We are soaking in God's word. This is the season for that. When we live here, some are going to work. Some are going to do other meetings. Some are going to family meetings. That is the season. But the season for God's word is not for other things. So if there's a season for you to bear fruit, and you are not bearing fruit, or you are even bearing fruit, but not that kind of fruit, then there is something wrong with you. So if you have done all the things that God says you are supposed to do about his laws, then you are going to be watered. Then you are going to bear fruit in season. Seasons are very, very important. Because sometimes I pity our ladies. There is a season for them.
That's not God's season, it's man's season though. When that season comes, you see your mother giving you trouble, you see your grandmother giving you trouble. I want to have that baby on my lap because they know that there is that season is ripe. That season is ripe. So things are done by seasons. But anyway, God's season supersedes all seasons. But the seasons of God are important. He brings forth its fruit in season, and his leaf shall not wither. Can you imagine that God has blessed you, but because you have opened a back door, all the blessings will be seeping out because you have opened a back door for it? Can you imagine that God has planted you by his living waters, and when your leaves grow, they become green within 2 or 3 days, then they become yellow, they become pale, and they fall? Your leaves will remain green if verse 1 and 2 applies to you. He said, and whatever he does prospers. Ooh, this is the icing on the cake. Whatever he does prospers. See, there are some of us, no matter how hard we try, yes, we come from a very good family. The family background is solid. So the connections are there. So whatever I want to do, I'll get it done. I am very much well educated. Whether formal education or informal, I have my profession on my hands. So definitely, and I know my job. I'm capable. But things are not working. But there is somebody, there are some people, I mean, like, they are really not serious about life, but any small thing they touch, it turns into gold. So whatever he touches prospers. Amen. So God is telling us that indeed his word is true. His word doesn't change because he's not man. And his word is settled. And that blessing is still hovering upon our heads. It's still around us. But it's only for us to stretch our hand and grab it. Because God will put the food before you, but you have to pick it and put it into your mouth. If you go and cut your hands, then someone else must feed you. And if you are supposed to be at the beck and call of people even to feed you, you can imagine how your life is going to be like. And God is again telling us that it doesn't matter what we are going through today. In as much as we believe in his word, in as much as we have faith in him, that his word is true, that everything he says in this book is, I like this song. He said, Lord, everything written about you is great. Everything written about you. See, this book, I have seen books and I've seen books. Even laws of nations, we always have amendments, because the amendments go according to the change of lifestyle of the people that the law is governing. When the people change, then they amend the laws. You see, they massage it so that at least it favors the people. People write books. They write scientific books, but they come and they bring volumes. This is a revised standard version. This is a revised version of what I've written, because things change. Because when I was a child, when I was in school, there were 9 planets. But today, there are 8 planets, because the definition of a planet has changed. But the word of God has not changed. Amen. The word of God, it is still true. And his testimonies are still ongoing. So if you are in the king's house today, whether you are suffering, whether you are going through any kind of affliction, whether you are agonizing, whether there's anxiety, his ways are true. And these ways are settled. There's no negotiations.
this morning, God is telling you that you are going to be blessed. God is saying that he has raised our standards against any kind of affliction that's afflicting you. God said that he is watching you carefully and he is channeling the water, living waters, down to your direction.
Amen.
You are going to be blessed. You are going to get out of every situation you find yourself in because he has spoken. He has not changed. He is still the same God of yesterday. He's the same God today. And he will continue to be the same God tomorrow. Amen.